Some among them were potentially dangerous. Most were loyal. But no one knew what would happen among this concentrated population if Japanese forces should try to invade our shores. Military authorities therefore determined that all of them, citizens and aliens alike, would have to move. This picture tells how the mass migration was accomplished.
Evacuation. More than 100,000 men, women, and children, all of Japanese ancestors, removed from their homes in the Pacific Coast states to wartime communities established in out-of-the-way places. Their evacuation did not imply individual disloyalty, but was ordered to reduce a military hazard at a time when danger of invasion was great. Two-thirds of the evacuees are American citizens by right of birth. The rest are their Japanese-born parents and grandparents. They are not under decision. They are not prisoners. They are not internees. They are merely dislocated people, the unwounded casualties of war. The relocation centers are supervised by the War Relocation Authority, which assumed responsibility for the people after they had been evacuated and cared for temporarily by the Army. The relocation centers, housing from 7 to 18,000 people, the entire community bounded by a wire fence and guarded by military police, symbols of the military nature of the evacuation. Each family, upon arrival at a relocation center, was assigned to a single room compartment, about 20 by 25 feet. Barren, unattractive. A stove, a light bulb, cots, mattresses, and blankets. Those were the things provided by the government.
In 1942, the United States government forcibly relocated over 112,000 Japanese nationals and Japanese Americans to remote housing facilities called war relocation camps for the purpose of detainment, re-education, and forced labor. Of those interned, 62% were United States citizens. President Franklin Roosevelt authorized the internment with Executive Order 9066, allowing military commanders to designate military areas as exclusion zones. This power was then used to declare the entire Pacific Coast as an exclusion zone, forbidding people of Japanese descent to live within these areas, unless, of course, they were held in war relocation camps. In 1944, the Supreme Court upheld the constitutionality of these exclusion zones, and in 1945, after 2.5 long years of imprisonment, the interns were finally released. The United States government issued no formal apologies, but did present each former inmate with exactly $25 in cash and a train ticket home, if they were lucky enough to still have one. 43 years later, in 1988, President Ronald Reagan would sign a bill that formally apologized for the internment of Japanese Americans on behalf of the United States government, and finally granted reparations to survivors. The language of the bill stated that government actions of the 1940s internments were based upon three criteria: racial prejudice, wartime hysteria, and a failure of political leadership.
So what is most important in this bill has less to do with capital than with honor. For here we admit a wrong. Here we reaffirm our commitment as a nation to equal justice under the law.
In 2001, following the attacks of September the 11th, our government again went into open roundup mode, detaining and imprisoning thousands of United States citizens, again seemingly based upon the same three criteria used to intern Japanese Americans: race prejudice, war hysteria, and a failure of political leadership. Let there be no argument. The United States government has put its own citizens in detention centers. The justifications for doing so range from personal prejudices based upon political and religious grounds to wartime frenzies and fears of future terrorist attacks. In a time of great crisis, the impossible becomes possible. Is it possible that internment camps are being built in the United States today? Is it possible that history will repeat itself?
Well, we used internment camps here in the United States during World War II. And we interned Japanese Americans. Or Americans, I should say, Americans of Japanese descent. And these people were cordoned off in duration of the war. Background checks could have been done, they could have been released or cleared out of those facilities. But it was thought best, because there was so much animosity toward the Japanese from the attack on Pearl Harbor and subsequent deaths of U.S. soldiers, that these people would just be kept outside in one of their detention facilities.
On April 1st, 1979, by Presidential Executive Order 12127, the Federal Emergency Management Agency was created for the purpose of coordinating the response to disasters that have occurred in the United States and that overwhelmed the resources of local and state authorities. Upon its creation, FEMA absorbed the Federal Insurance Administration, the National Fire Prevention and Control Administration, the National Weather Service Community Preparedness Program, as well as several other federal-level preparedness programs. FEMA was also given the responsibility for overseeing the United States Civil Defense, a function which had previously been performed by the DoD's Defense Civil Preparedness Agency. In 2003, FEMA became part of the Department of Homeland Security's Emergency Preparedness and Response Directorate. FEMA follows three simple directives. 1. National Emergency Recovery. 2. Continuity of Government. And 3. Combating perceived threats to the existing social and political order. FEMA's implicit objective to provide aid to victims of disasters changed under the leadership of President George W. Bush. Although some may argue, prior to the Bush administration, FEMA's reaction time for responding to and the handling of national emergencies was beginning to improve. But in 2003, President Bush would shift the focus of responding to emergencies in America by placing FEMA under the umbrella of the Department of Homeland Security, whose stated objective was and still is to protect our nation from dangerous people. Did the Bush administration's war on terror mentality take priority over the government's emergency response to provide aid to victims during a national disaster?
We're fighting evil.
And I remember my first words to him, Mr. President, my estimate is that 90% of the population of New Orleans has now been displaced. 90%? Yes, sir, I believe it is that, and that's how bad it is. I really thought that would get just the whole mechanism of the federal government to come charging in, is once again this mentality that it's a natural disaster. It's a hurricane. It's not Al-Qaeda.
The most important job of government is to protect the homeland.
In the midst of a searing heat wave, Jefferson County residents lined up in their cars for food and water, wondering what took so long.
Slow. Everything is slow.
The man who runs the county, Judge Carl Griffith, agrees. And in a meeting with President Bush this morning, said FEMA's delivery of relief supplies was unacceptably slow.
Save American lives, we must be able to act fast.
Real distrust of the federal government, especially with the levee system, because now the Army Corps has pushed that date back now to 2011. It's supposed to be up by 2010.
As requests for emergency assistance poured in after Hurricane Katrina, one applicant listed this as his address, the Greenwood Cemetery in New Orleans, being promptly issued a check for $2,358 for rental assistance. That's just one of thousands of examples of alleged fraud and abuse described in a new report by the investigative arm of Congress, costing the taxpayers about $1 billion.
The examples are so egregious that what they tell us is that FEMA didn't perform even the basic checks to these safeguard taxpayers' money.
Well, today the outrage spread to Congress, where House members accused FEMA of a cover-up. 2 years after Katrina's 76,000 FEMA trailers are still being used to house families who lost their homes. Many of the trailers have high levels of formaldehyde, which can result in dangerous respiratory problems.
Three of my children began having severe nosebleeds several times a week.
It got so bad that this Tuesday I actually had to take it.
Several deaths may well be linked to toxic levels of formaldehyde gas.
It is a sick organization, and it has totally lost the confidence of the people of America.
Overnight, FEMA decided to stop issuing debit cards at Houston shelters, but almost no one there hoping for a card had any idea.
Call everybody up in the van and come up here and we came and get work. They said we were ready.
Even Houston's relief coordinators told FEMA a heads up would have been helpful.
We just would make sure everyone understood that every time they change their mind in Washington, D.C., it affects the people here that are trying to deal with tens of thousands of people.
We're talking about damage from Hurricane Rita last year, two devastated schools, and kids and parents waiting for help. A few months ago, the folks at FEMA told the schools, one in Iberia Parish and one in Vermilion Parish in Louisiana, that they would get millions to relocate to higher ground. FEMA even helped them draw up the plan. And then FEMA took it back.
Endless delays, he says, caused by FEMA, which just last week delayed money for rebuilding yet again.
They're more worried about their own positions in FEMA, their own salaries, than the recovery process now.
There is a new pitch to report about those infamous FEMA trailers. After spending nearly $3 billion taxpayer dollars to buy them, it turned out many went unused. And now FEMA is unloading them at bargain basement prices while other people need them.
After a lengthy investigation, the congressional architects of the Department of Homeland Security concluded today that FEMA, the agency that is supposed to respond to hurricanes and national disasters, should be taken out of the mantle of Homeland Security bureaucracy, disbanded, and put back together in a better way, and placed under direct control of the president or the emergency.
A Senate report on the government's response to Hurricane Katrina says FEMA is so far beyond repair that the agency should be scrapped.
It said that agency failed in its view to anticipate and then respond to Katrina.
FEMA is discredited, demoralized, and dysfunctional. FEMA is discredited, demoralized, and dysfunctional.
Mid-1970s, credit by the government was more scared of the public than ever, coming off the years of Richard Nixon. And so two cold warriors inside the White House, Gerald Ford, began to bring back the Cold War idea of an executive takeover of the United States through an emergency federal agency. Those individuals, Donald Rumsfeld and Dick Cheney. And so really, what you see being set up by James Carter in 1979 is just a continuation of federal policy to expand a federal takeover plan for continuity of government. So that's what the Federal Emergency Management Agency was really set up for. Spend the dollar right. hands over every agency. But now when you watch FEMA on television, it's always a colonel or a general or an admiral in the government department.
The martial law portion of Rec City 4 were outlined in the 1982 memo written by FEMA Deputy John Brinkerhoff. Martial law was to be declared in the event of a national crisis, yet the plan did not define the term national crisis. The plan allowed FEMA to take control of both federal and state governments, appointing military commanders to replace FEMA officials. The plan also called for the rounding up of at least 21 million American Negroes for delivery to numerous military bases converted into prison centers, also known as FEMA relocation camps. Why? Because at that time, African Americans were classified as one of the largest threats to the continuity of the federal government. Who does the federal government consider the biggest threat these days?
The convergence of globalization and technology has created a new kind of terrorism. There were persons who, for whatever reason, came to view their home country as an enemy.
Kind of right-wing, religious-based domestic terrorism.
Disturbing news tonight about homegrown terror.
Part of this is big change in the White House and cultural experience, and some of the crazies are coming out of the closet.
Right now, it looks like there is no connection between the man arrested and any known terrorist cell.
Homegrown,
I should say.
Folks, we've got a very serious situation here. I'm holding what is called the right-wing extremism, current economic and political climate, fueling resurgence and radicalization and recruitment. And in it, we talked about the fact that they define pro-lifers as domestic terrorists. They put this in a Department of Homeland Security document, this official assessment, now saying pro-lifers, people that believe in end-time prophecies, people that are opposed to the administration's position on immigration, those of us that are standing up for the sanctity of life and for the sanctity of marriage, all of those are now potential, and this is what they're saying, domestic terrorists.
It's a terrorist next door that could be our bigger threat.
They call people who believe in the sanctity of life, who believe in owning firearms, who believe in serving their country in the military and coming back, who are very concerned about the policies that this nation is embarking on, spending too much money, taxing too much. It's all listed right here. These are the domestic right-wing extremists.
1 million names under the watchful eye of the United States. America's so-called terrorist watch list has hit the record number, according to one of the country's most prominent civil liberties groups.
That's a lot of people to keep track of. They're adding new people all the time.
It's a secret list that you don't know really quite how one gets on, and you don't know how you get off.
You should be considered a potential threat. And you couple that with things like the Patriot Act, where if you are a threat in their eyes, you can be held without access to judge, jury, and without access to a lawyer, or even to your family. That's very concerning, because you watch our country to do this to brown people. You know, what we're seeing is the rounding up enemy combatants, and they're putting them in camps, and they are torturing them.
May 2007, President Bush signed the National Security Presidential Directive 51. The unclassified portion of NSPD 51 states that in the event of catastrophic emergency, cooperative efforts from the executive, legislative, and judicial branches of the federal government, coordinated by the president, will replace normal governmental procedures.
Most Americans would agree that it would be prudent to have a plan to provide the continuity of government. They have set the plan. They introduced a little sketchy public version that's clearly inadequate and doesn't really tell us what they have in mind. But they said, don't worry, there's a detailed classified version. But now they've denied the entire Homeland Security Committee of the United States House of Representatives access to their so-called detailed plan to provide for continuity of government. They say, trust us. Trust us.
George W. Bush or Barack H. Obama, the corruption, the tyranny just expands like PDD 51. The president says, Congress, you have no authority over any way the government runs ever again.
during an emergency, the presidency runs everything. You are literally titular, you are a figurehead, you are ceremonial. And congressmen, then on the Homeland Security Committee, is high level clearance of the president, so we want to see the entire PDD. And the White House says, no, you don't get to see it because PDD 51 removes you from that process. This is high treason. It is high treason to have the executive telling the Congress, you can't see Presidential Decision Directive 51. You can't see its accompanying executive order. You don't have the authority over anything anymore.
FEMA is dysfunctional.
This is high treason against the people.
The FBI's counterintelligence program was a series of covert and often illegal programs conducted by the United States government and aimed squarely at investigating and disrupting dissident political organizations within the United States. According to a Senate Select Committee study chaired by Senator Frank Church and including such members as Phil Hart, Walter Mondale, and Barry Goldwater, the FBI's motivation for conducting these programs was protecting national security, preventing violence, and maintaining the existing social and political order. Targets included the Black Panther Party, the Ku Klux Klan, communist and socialist organizations, as well as non-violent civil rights organizations, anti-war groups, and a broad range of organizations lumped together under the title New Left, which included groups labeled for intensified attention, such as the Southern Christian Leadership Conference, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, and Congress of Racial Equality. Over the course of four presidential administrations, FBI Director J. Edgar Hoover ordered FBI agents to expose, disrupt, misdirect, discredit, or otherwise neutralize the activities of these movements and their leaders. Speakers, teachers, and writers, even individual student demonstrators with no group affiliation, were all fair game. Individual case studies revealed that the FBI was successful in preventing the distribution of books, newspapers, and periodicals. They prevented groups from forming and disrupted peaceful demonstrations and large anti-war marches, as well as denied groups and organizations facilities to hold meetings and conferences. According to attorney Brian Glick in his book War at Home, the FBI used four main methods for their counterintelligence program. Number one, infiltration. Getting agents on the inside in order to undermine trust and scare off potential supporters. Number two, psychological warfare. Planting false media stories, forging correspondence, making anonymous phone calls, spreading misinformation about meetings and events, setting up pseudo-movement groups run by government agents, and manipulating and threatening parents, employers, landlords, school officials, and others to cause trouble for activists. Number three, harassment through the legal system. The FBI and police abuse the legal system to harass dissidents and make them appear to be criminal. Officers of the law gave perjured testimony and presented fabricated evidence as a pretext for false arrest and wrongful imprisonment. They also discriminatorily enforce tax laws and other government regulations. Number four, extralegal force and violence. The FBI and police threaten, instigated, and themselves conducted break-ins, vandalism, assaults, and beatings, all in the name of maintaining the existing social and political order.
Justices after their home addresses were revealed in a webcast by self-proclaimed white supremacists. Welcome to the Hal Turner Show.
right out of the Project Veto report back in 1999 by the FBI, describing what terrorists were, how law enforcement could identify potential terrorists. And I can remember back in the 90s, the FBI was doing an education program with local law enforcement, and what they had was a trifold pamphlet. Again, this was not meant for public consumption, only to be passed around amongst the rank and file of the police. It ran through the list of what a potential terrorist might be or what they might prescribe to. And the list is kind of interesting. If you're a supporter of the Constitution, if you're an ardent supporter of the Second Amendment, or even if you were a person of deep religious conviction, you might be a member of a certain cult. Going back to Project Veto, it's all basically the same thing. That if you have any strong beliefs in anything, that you could be a constant threat, you could be a terrorist threat against government structure.
In Missouri, a new document meant to help Missouri law enforcement agencies identify militia members or domestic terrorists has drawn criticism. The February 20 report called the modern militia movement mentioned such red flags as political bumper stickers for third-party candidates, such as Ron Paul, who ran for president. Talk of conspiracy theories, such as the plan on the superhighway linking Canada to Mexico, and possession of subversive literature. So the state police in Missouri were told that if you see a car with a bumper sticker that opposes the so-called creation of North American Union, the superhighway, that you're probably following a militia, that you are following an anti-government rally. If you see a car with a bumper sticker that says Ron Paul for president, you might be dealing with a violent radical. Exercise extreme caution.
On the anarchist movement. You've got it on the modern committees of safety.
Voice of the People or Militias in Disguise. That's January 9, 2009, which came out right before the infamous MIAC strategic report on the modern militia movement. So they've been producing these documents for quite some time. If the people profiled in this document could be considered a peaceful threat to law enforcement, that means they could be considered a potential domestic terrorist. And if you have the word terrorist attached to your name, whether it is domestic or foreign, the Patriot Act still applies to you when you're an American citizen.
I remind you that before the Nazis began to persecute and incarcerate and kill and so forth the Jewish people in Germany, the first thing they did was label them as extremists and fanatics and all these kind of things and get the people conditioned against them. And then with the approbation of the general populace, they were able to unleash the fury of the state against them, and we all of course know what happened as a result of that.
Language that comes out of organized
activism. The elites have said that they want to have a final revolution. Then they know the public's going to revolt against them. So that's why they've scientifically set up the surveillance grid, the cashless society. This whole continuity of government system is designed to suppress and control the people of America. NORTHCOM, the Pentagon, the military are all announcing their number one job now is fighting the American people. They're saying the number one terror threat is veterans, and gun owners, and conservatives, and libertarians, and Ron Paul's supporters. And I've been sent secret army documents, call the phone numbers, and they're accurate and real, where I'm being watched that in the Fed protest, where we peacefully go out and demonstrate. And now even the ACLU has written letters saying, why is the Pentagon watching a U.S. citizen? Why are you listing any protest as an act of terrorism? The real terrorists are the people that have hijacked our nation that would dare say the First Amendment is terrorism.
Two new reports out document an alarming rise in the number of hate groups in the United States. The Southern Poverty Law Center's intelligence report found 926 active hate groups in the country. That's up more than 50% from just 2000. Morris Dees is the founder of the Southern Poverty Law Center. He joins us from Montgomery, Alabama. Good morning, sir. Your report dovetails with a brand new report from the Department of Homeland Security claiming basically the same thing. And they say part of it is because of the election of President Obama. Other part of the responsibility goes to the deteriorating economy.
Political climate, the election of Obama, the immigration issues that have faced the United States over the last 5 to 10 years, and now especially the economy, is almost causing a resurgence of what we saw in the days of Timothy McVeigh, almost a militia movement that's being reborn in the United States.
Homeland Security says people who oppose abortion or worry about the threat of illegal aliens could pose a radical
threat to America.
It warns about groups and individuals dedicated to single-issue Trump abortion, immigration, and gun rights, and even raises a red flag about veterans returning home from the wars in Iraq and Afghanistan.
This report seems to lump in ordinary Americans who have real concerns about stuff with nut job racists and anti-Semites.
There's one thing that's glaringly missing here. No discussion about the real terrorists. The Al-Qaeda cell groups and others that are located inside the United States.
It literally changes the entire focus for the part of the
Homeland Security.
I was passed by an Oklahoma State police officer vehicle. They slowed down, got in behind me, followed me for about 3 miles, and then pulled me over. When the officers approached my vehicle, they asked me if I knew why I was being pulled over, and I said, no, I had no idea. And they said, it's because of the sign in the back of your truck. And I said, my sign that says abort Obama, not the unborn? And the officers said, yes, that's why. Later that afternoon, I got a call from the Secret Service. They wanted to do a quick walkthrough of my house to make sure I wasn't some kind of radical racist.
Why did Americans, under the guise of political war on terrorism, why did they willingly give up or relinquish their rights to government? Well, our rights did not come from government in the first place. Our rights merely came from God, but they were enumerated by the government to put in the Bill of Rights as a reminder, not to us, but those in power as to not violate them.
No, the history of government, not just American government, the history of government, well enough to know that most governments acquire power and they do not like dissent. We are losing our freedom in the United States. Most Americans do not realize that we have free speech zones in the United States. I mean, talk about an oxymoron. You know, all of the 50 states are a free speech zone. You're an American. That, by definition, creates a free speech zone. We have freedom of speech because we stand up and say what we think, not because the Founding Fathers ratified the First Amendment in 1791. So if we're losing the free speech zones, the governments in general throughout history have tried to quell dissent by controlling the media, which we already have in this country, and by generating fear of confrontation.
After Seattle, the Fed said we can't allow protests anymore. It's too dangerous. That's why we're going to have free speech zones miles away from where the events are, in baseball fields, in church parking lots, where nobody can see you or hear you. You've got your First Amendment, but you've got it way over here miles away. That all started as a beta test in Seattle in 99, with the police, after they staged the riot, with hired anarchists coming up to people saying nowhere in the city that they even wear a pin saying no WTO. Police say, hey, First Amendment is suspended in Seattle, and the news pushed it like it was a good idea and the right thing to do.
I was recently looking around on westernarmy.mil, and I came across a document called the Civilian Inmate Labor Program, put on 2005. I was just like reading over the first couple pages. Just the first couple pages, this document on the Army's own website talks about converting the military bases and installations into giant prisons and establishing a Civilian Inmate Labor Program. Have you ever heard of this? This is on army.mil,
looking up 2005.
On the Army's website.
Yeah, so rather than in prison, right?
Well, I don't know, but, I mean, obviously there's a document that...
Yeah, there are lots of documents in the
military.
Yeah, okay.
Army.mil.
Okay. But Army.mil, the link is broken. Can you use Army? I can't use Army.mil.
Army regulations. Now, this was set up in 1986 secretly, and for 10 plus years it was secret. And in 1997, Bill Clinton declassified this. We were the first major radio show to cover it. Since then, it's been expanded. This list, 12 camps, whole
built by the United States Army. And ladies and gentlemen, some of these facilities have U.S. citizens in them now. But it's all being done administratively to make a test the Army running plans, dated deals with the federal government and now states to take prisoners convicted in the civilian courts and to then stick them on U.S. military bases administered by the Bureau of Prisons, but operated by the U.S. Army. So see, they're taking state and federal prisoners and sticking them under Army control and building these civilian-made labor camps, all under Rex 84, right out in the open, and no media will ever touch this.
Beginning in October, the Army plans to station an active unit inside the United States.
Under NORTHCOM and under the new Homeland Brigade, it's first going to be 3,000, and then 20,000, and then 40,000.
The 3rd Infantry Division's 1st Brigade Combat Team has spent 35 of the last 60 months in Iraq.
Combat hardened troops who've been running camps and centers in Iraq are now coming back to the United States to, quote, carry out law enforcement actions.
The Army unit may be called upon to help with civil unrest and crowd control.
There has been some concern and some questions that I'd like to correct. The primary purpose of this force is to provide help to people in need in the aftermath of a WFD-like event in the homeland. This force has got no role in civil disturbance or civil unrest, any of those kinds of things.
Army Times reporting, quote, they may be called upon to help with civil unrest and crowd control or to deal with potentially horrific scenarios, end quote.
NORTHCOM, the Northern Command, that came into being in October 2002, when that came in, people like me were concerned that the Pentagon was going to use its forces here in the United States, and now it looks like, in fact, it is, even though on its website it says it doesn't have units of its own. Now it's getting a unit of its own.
The Army Times said during civil unrest inside the United States, the Army's new job would be engaging American people.
The Posse-Comitatus Act of 1878 generally prohibits federal uniformed services from carrying out domestic law enforcement duties, except in cases expressly authorized by the Constitution or an act of Congress.
They can't just come in and say, you know, I want to see everything in the car, I want to see everything in the house, I'm going to go through your computer. You either have to voluntarily hand that over to them, or they have to have probable cause and get a warrant to do that. So it's very clear that the government does not have the authority to be spying on us. That was not the intent of our founders when they created this system of government.
Over the last decade, we've seen the introduction and enactment of some of the most dangerous legislation ever to be conceived by our elected officials, who have not forgotten who they serve, but only now reveal to the American people, through the fruit of their own actions, that our rights and our freedoms are secondary. The USA Patriot Act allows for American citizens to be picked up and incarcerated indefinitely without charges, and allows law enforcement to conduct warrantless and secret searches of Americans' property and possessions. The Military Commissions Act dissolved the cornerstone of our Constitution by removing the writ of habeas corpus, allowing the permanent imprisonment of enemy combatants, and disallowing petitions to the court to know why you've been locked up in the first place. Although never passed by the Senate, the Violent Radicalization and Homegrown Terrorism Prevention Act shows us the mindset of our leaders in Washington. If passed into law, the bill would make public demonstrations and protesting into an act of terrorism, and label the organizers as thought criminals and potential homegrown terrorists. Now that the federal government has the authority to sneak, snatch, and lock up its own citizens, a new bill has been introduced by Congress that gives the feds a place to hold those outspoken dissenters and potential domestic terrorists. The National Emergency Centers Establishment Act, or H.R. 645, allocates military bases to be converted into FEMA emergency centers. It also mandates that these camps be built complete with public works, medical, and educational facilities, just like the Japanese internment camps of the 1940s.
Why is the media on one hand saying there are no FEMA units, on the other hand, legislation has been introduced and built?
H.R. 645, titled the National Emergency Centers Act, directs the Secretary of Homeland Security to establish national emergency centers throughout the United States.
It's all been done. It's not good.
The bill directs these camps to be built on existing military installations, whether operational or not, for the stated purpose of providing temporary housing to meet other hopefully,
needs
as determined by the Secretary of Defense.
Here's H.R. 645, legalizing what has already been developed, it's already been paid for by FEMA. And that is these FEMA camps where everybody's safe, these FEMA camps where everybody's comfort, these FEMA camps that the people need during emergencies.
The government doesn't build things that are not needed, or that there aren't contingency plans that say there's a reason for them. So much better reported by a WorldNet family that the Department of Homeland Security has already awarded nearly a $400 million contract to Alan Berkman to build some temporary detention centers on an as-needed basis.
We know this is their main attack profile. These old, shut-down bases. So you go point them out and go, look, the barbed wire station. Look, this is a designated FEMA. They said, well, where are the people? Where are the people in the camp? The point is, it's a designated facility for them.
Conceivably, these are the kinds of camps that could be used for political dissidents, just like occurred in Nazi Germany.
I got a feeling in the next few years that you may start to see some American citizens end up in these camps for questioning the government.
The president can declare a national emergency, and it can be anything. It can be a hurricane, or it can be political protests or civil disorders like we saw in the race riot. I think the government's anticipating that there's going to be an increased reaction against the economic downturn, and this could lead to kinds of street riots and protests we've seen in countries such as France.
If we do not have a government which is controlled and limited by the Constitution, then our personal motives and preferences are irrelevant. You know, it doesn't matter if you have freedom of speech, if you're in a FEMA concentration camp. It doesn't matter. You know, you're certainly not going to be allowed to have a gun inside a concentration camp. And, you know, all of our rights are predicated on a free America. And if we don't have a free America, all the other questions become moot.
Don't these governments have a responsibility morally? They're in there building camps, building shackles, building barbed wire, facing industries out. Who said it's not constitutional in the United States? Well, of course they do, but how long Brown and Root was connected to some of the contracts that went on at Camp Express, Guantanamo Bay, in Cuba. So this is their business.
I talked to the Department of Homeland Security spokespeople, and they affirmed the contract with the KBR, the former Halliburton company, was in place. The Department of Homeland Security was ready to build the contingency as needed detention centers anywhere in the country in the event of any kind of a national emergency, including natural disasters or attacks.
Just because you think someone might commit a crime doesn't mean that they have done anything. And does not mean that you have the right to punish them for what you think they are going to do. You know, in our system of government, you're supposed to be innocent until you're proven guilty, not guilty until you're proven innocent. And so you can be declared guilty or potentially guilty before you even lift a finger, that is bordering on thought crime. That is bordering on punishing people for pre-crime.
never understood youth work before the thought police showed up at my front door. Liberty is something that we touch, we feel, we grasp, and feel. We can't taste it, smell it, feel it. It doesn't have a particular shape or size or color. It's intangible, elusive, and in terms of the human emotion, felt that women and guys are divine for care.
Modern tyranny is a lot more sophisticated than the Hitlerian or Stalinesque things we've seen in the past. But even in Hitler's day, they knew how to sell it. And they advertised the camps as, hey, look, people don't like you here in the Warsaw Ghetto. You're not allowed to have jobs. You're not allowed to work. Get on the trains. We're coming to take you to a safer place. You're going to be able to work, be amongst your own people. They put them on trains, took them to the camps, killed the old and infirm, worked the other people to death. And they advertised, hey, we're going to de-louse you, we're going to give you a shower, march right in here.